Coming up on Theater Talk.
The big stars of your show
are the Kinky Boots.
And guess what?
I brought Michael Size.
Theater Talk is made possible in part by the CUNY TV Foundation. York City, this is the
And we're already having a good time because we have two very, very enjoyable shows.
That's right, my darling.
Cut him off.
Yes, no, no. Go right ahead.
You may have recognized our two guests. Harvey Fierstein, our old and dear, dear friend, has yet another hit musical on Broadway, a terrific show called Kinky Boots, with, by the way, a great score from a Broadway newcomer, the great Cyndi Lauper.
Well, thank you very much.
I love your story.
You're
legendary.
And I'm here with, I'm sorry, your name again is?
Oh, my God.
The far out Susan Haskins.
That's right.
Woo!
I've known for many hundreds of years.
That's right.
And I need no introduction, but of course I'm Michael Riedel of the New York Post.
Which gets nothing right.
Thank you very much.
Ouch.
All right, Cyndi. Tell me, how did you get dragged into this wacky world of Broadway?
Well, I was washing the dishes one night. I had just come off a tour in Europe, and it was like a bit of a punishment tour because it was one of those tours where they said, you got to just play the clubs for a little bit, rough it, it's rock and roll. So I did. And, you know, it's really rough when you're in Europe with one of those double-decker buses, and if you're the, you know, the singer, they put you in the back thinking that that's, like, really great. And I tell you, I felt like I was in a washer-dryer the whole time. Every time I went to, I fell on this side, I went on that side. I felt like
Get
to the part that applies to me. Okay.
Anyway, from Kinky Boots.
So when I got back, I was, you know, pretty disgusted, and he called me up, and I've always wanted to work with Harvey, actually. And I just finished the dishes. He said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Actually, nothing." And I had time. And I was really excited to be able to write music.
Had you ever had
Jerry Mitchell?
That was the big plus. Not just him, but Jerry too.
Yeah, that's what she said.
Had you ever had any ambitions to write a Broadway musical in your life?
Well, we talked about it.
Yeah, we talked about doing it. There was something else I wanted to do, and I haven't done it.
Because you grew up here in New York. Did you go to Broadway shows as a kid? Were you interested in the Broadway musical?
We didn't have the money to go to a show, but my mother had Broadway cast albums, and that's how I learned how to sing. In fact, I played that King and I around four. I played it every day, and I would copy the voices, you know. And my grandmother actually came downstairs, took the record off of my little red record player without saying a word, just walked back upstairs with it, because they played it every day.
And I hope you kept right on singing.
Well, when Funny Girl came on, she gave up.
So. similar story for you, right, Harvey?
I sat and I lip-synced to all those records also, except my mother insisted on taking us to the theater. But back then, you know, balcony tickets were $2, you know, so the four of us could go for $2 a piece, and she would buy tickets immediately. She had Stubbs magazine, you know, and she...
Oh, wow.
I mean, my mother's like she and her friends were like the backbone of American
theater. My mother didn't know that. She took us to the Delacorte Theater a lot. We saw a lot of Shakespeare.
So you saw
free stuff,
But I was thinking that your video Girls Just Want to Have Fun, which was one of the seminal videos, it was very theatrical. It was like a little Broadway play.
Well, more than that, it was also kind of political. And I realized that I knew what I was doing, and I insisted on making sure that it was multiracial so that every little girl, no matter who, what color she was, could see herself in the video and know that she too was entitled to a joyful experience. And, you know, I was so nutty, I got away with it. Nobody looked at me like I had a brain, so I figured it's the visual. And I love filmic things. And that's what, you know, in the musical.
She's like...
I've trained her. I've trained her. Because she keeps saying, well, I guess we'll go see the play. It's not a play, it's a musical. I've trained her. I've done a good job.
No, it's why, true.
You were going to say what you were going to say.
He is.
I feel like we're about to do Virginia Woolf or something.
Oh my God, that's too depressing.
Good. But what were you going to say? You said in the musical, you were going to say something about you painted the sets and Jacques Tati was important to you. Was something about?
Well, yes, and when I watched, you know, because after a while, honestly, you don't. It's so different for me because you don't get a dressing room. You're sitting in the theater, and after a while, you're walking around in the dark, taking notes and listening and watching. And I felt like a little theater rat. I felt like a little rat, always sneaking around, watching, listening, writing.
That's me.
And then I would watch Jerry and how he would do these filmic things. To me, it was like film. And that's my favorite part of the musical. Besides the actors, after a while, honestly, you start to fall in love with the different characters. And you just, you know, I feel sometimes very lonesome. We were talking today, you know, lonesome for everybody because I spent 4.5 years and who knew at first, you know, I didn't know it was going to be that. But honestly, I would do it again. It was these group of people and you promised me and you kept your promise. There were no nut jobs and no nasty people and no, everybody was there for the work.
I know, that's why I didn't get all those juicy columns about the show out of town.
What do you mean?
Because I write about when they're in trouble and they're fighting and there's all sorts of trouble and problems.
Jerry's genius was amazing because we had this show in the rehearsal room, you know, over on 42nd Street that just was blowing the walls and the ceiling off the room. I mean, everybody left there in tears and thrilled and it was unbelievable. We put it up on the stage in Chicago and
it's different.
And it was different. The sets, the costumes, the lighting were overwhelming it. And I got a little panicked. I mean, I've been there before and I got a little panicked. But Jerry was just like, I mean, he's a genius. He just was like, calm down.
Right.
We'll get our show back. And then step by step, light by light, that's what she was talking about, focus by focus, you stand there. The eye has to follow this way. The light should come this way. And just focused, and slowly the show came back. Once the show was back, then we were able to say, okay, this is what we want to do, that's what we want.
We can now add a little bit more.
Exactly.
And we should say, for people who have not seen the show, just going to your point, if it had been overblown the first time in Chicago, Kinky Boots is a very intimate story based on the popular independent
movie. It's a true story, and it's a fable. I mean, it really is a fable.
And just it's about a.
Wait, it's a true story. It's not so much a fable.
It's a true story.
Yeah, that actually happened. It's about a factory. Mm-hmm. It's a family factory, 5 generations of this
shoe
factory in Northampton, which is in the middle of England, a whole town that made shoes. And because of cheap imports, most of these manufacturers were going out of business. And this one kid, he didn't really want to be in the business. He wanted to go off, and so.
But he didn't know what he wanted.
But he didn't know what he wanted to do. He just knew he didn't want to do what his father wanted him to do. And his father died, left him the business. Business is failing. By accident, he ends up meeting a drag queen who says, if I could just get a pair of high heel boots that could stand up to a man wearing high heel boots. And these unlikely people become friends, get the idea to save the factory by making boots. But that's not what the show's about. I mean, that's the basic story. But
well,
it's really about these two people. No?
I think it's about a guy in these days, in this day and age, when everything is so, you know, this guy thought outside the box and took a chance on doing something a little differently. And these people overcame their differences for the greater good.
But it's about the two guys who turn out, the drag queen's father wanted him to be a boxer.
Right.
The other one's father wanted him to be a shoe manufacturer. They both feel like failures to their parents. And then they come together and they end up healing each other. And they end up accepting each other, and then the big hard thing to do is eventually they accept themselves.
Let me ask you, Harvey, when you
that was very, very, very sophisticated.
I do it for a living.
I know. I really admire that.
But
no, I do.
But you write a beautiful tune.
I could write a hook.
She writes a hook.
Let me ask you about that though. When you were working on the show, why didn't you go to the usual Broadway suspects to write a show?
You know,
why did you think of Cyndi Lauper?
The producers talked to a couple of other teams and the stuff they were sort of presenting to us sounded like cabaret music. They sounded like they sounded like songs. They didn't sound like something new. They didn't sound like something different. And I thought, with Cyndi, I said, she'd never done it before. And like I said, we'd already talked about doing this thing called her grandma's garden. But
It's my grandmother's garden.
Oh, really? But what I knew was I could start her with the numbers that happened in the drag club.
Club scene, club
they wouldn't, right, those would be like sort of natural for her, right. And then go on. But no, not with this one. You don't hold this one back. This one started with one of the hardest songs. She started with the opening of the show, where each character defines their life by shoes.
That was
fun. And every character has their own melody. Yeah. I mean, she went for the most sophisticated thing in the
show. The hardest thing to do for a musical is the opening number, because you have to set the tone for the rest of the show.
And see, ignorance is bliss, so I didn't know. I just thought it was interesting.
And
if it wasn't,
it
I would have fixed it.
And it turned out interesting.
And I did fix it, too.
But there was some fun. We had some fun things. Like she'd give me a song, and then I'd say, oh, great, I'll send it into the script. And so I'd put the lyrics in, and then the song would stop, and there'd be some talking. Then the song would start again. She says, what are you doing to my song? Just let them sing the song. I said, the show has to go on. Cindy. She's like, let them sing the song. They don't do that to Rodgers and Hammerstein. I said, yes, they do. I said, take a look. And then I showed her some things. She goes, oh, yeah. I said, because if it's done right, you don't notice.
No, it's not that. It was the hook.
Yeah.
You don't take the hook away. And I used to get nervous about the chorus, the hook.
Right, right.
The thing that people remember.
You ain't nervous no more,
no,
are you?
No, I think we did it good. And you know what? I think I also changed a whole thing because, you know, if you have to keep stopping the song to do dialogue, then I didn't do my job. And I got to go back and do the right thing for him.
You know, because you know, people don't know what a book is. People think the book is the spoken stuff like a play.
Yeah.
But they don't realize you can't have characters that speak one way and sing another. It has to be fluid.
Yeah.
They have to sound like the same person when they're singing or speaking. So if she would write them a certain way, I had to go back and adjust everybody. You can't, the book tells you where songs are. If a song lands, it's, of course, because of the direction, of course, because of the choreography, of course, because of the song, but the book has to set that song up. I mean, she called me up.
I called him up so many times.
Harvey,
he named
just
me
record.
Christina. And he became Mommy Dearest.
I'm Mommy Dearest. Christina. I said, Christina,
I
need those lyrics. But she would say to me, could you just record yourself saying what you wanted to say?
Oh, I see.
Or could you write this? And, you know, you create a song however.
No, because I wanted the tone of the cadence of what he was saying. You know, a lot of times, like for me, because of the way I learned how to sing, it was the first time in my life that I could actually write a song with, you know, My Fair Lady's father in it.
Yeah.
And I can write a song that's kind of like, oh, this is kind of like Billy Joel, although she sounds nothing like Billy Joel. and the little boy that's the little boy's thing. And it was fun to be able to do that. And I did it very unconventionally. And when I called up Harvey and said, what are the rules? He said, there are no rules. Just write, Christina.
Right, just people will say no to you. Don't do that to yourself. You'll say no to yourself. You just write. We'll tell you if it's good or bad later. Yeah. We'll try and make it work.
Did you guys?
But what she did,
I wanted
is she
to
actually
please
went
them.
Back and wrote for the actors.
Yeah. Well, because you have to, because, you know, it's like
not
a
everybody
good
does,
shoe.
Though.
You can't run in a bad shoe. You've got to have the right shoe to win the race.
To make sure fits your foot and no one's
like it
foot.
Says,
but
you could tell about a fella from his shoe, right?
But not everybody does. You know, most composers that I've found, they are very involved with their own sound. They want, and not Alan Menken. Who's that with me right here? But composers can sometimes care about their sound. Cyndi really cared about the actor's sound, and is this comfortable for them?
But I was very, very impressed with how the variety in the score.
Well, you see, when you get to write a musical, you don't have the record company saying, you can't write that. Oh, well, I'm imitating you now. It's not, you're Cyndi Lauper, you have to sing like this. And for the first time in my life, I saw two different characters. And I believe strongly that everybody talks with a different rhythm. everybody listens to a different kind of music. So I thought he is a perfect opportunity to reflect life a little more. He's making different characters. Why not have Lola have her style of music? Charlie has his style of music. And that was a challenge because what I originally thought was good for him was good for me. Mm. Not good for him.
Well, he hadn't been cast yet.
No, and when I heard it.
Stark is so beautiful and has that lovely sort of angelic-y kind of, how do you,
honestly,
his voice.
Stark Sands has, as I've been making the record with my guys and everything, his voice is very much a classic pop voice. I wondered at first, like when I saw him, he's not like Elvis Costello or any of that. That's what I originally wrote.
So you originally had sort of an Elvis Costello figure in mind for the Stark Sands?
Yeah, because I thought English, working class, that kind of sound, that kind of squeeze, that, you know, it's almost blue collar, but it's not. It's very literate if you listen to their songs. And I was always a fan of that. And then here comes Stark Sands, and he's embodying every other part of it. And I'm starting to watch him sing and thinking, oh, man. First, I sent him everything I had for this other song, Soul of a Man. Because for me, you know, writing is like cooking. Little of this, little of that. If you listen to West Side Story, that's what I listened to that taught me that. Mm-hmm. You know, the use of all of that with a classical foundation.
Right.
You could mix anything.
Yeah.
So that's what I did with Soul of a Man. And I started sending him like big files of songs. Then they had a meeting because they didn't think that song worked either. And I was, you know, I was like, well, I could just change the words. I think the music is really good. And then I looked at them and I said, yeah, honestly, if I knew it was going to be him, I would have never written a song like that.
And that's the hard part.
But that's writing, that's creating a musical.
Yeah,
you've got to be willing to throw, you got to throw stuff out. Was there ever a moment, though, in this collaboration, because I know you guys have become great friends, but were you ever really at each other in any way? Was there any sort of...
I got hurt once, but it wasn't about that. It was about, you know, I'm always the only woman. Mm. In my whole career, I'm always, you know, I mean, I try and work with women, but I like Harvey. I don't care if he's a man or a woman. He's a great writer. He's funny. He's fun. But it never really got
hurt. When did you get hurt?
I told you. I left you that voice message, and then you called me up and said, Christina.
What happened? You have to tell us the story. You're leaving us hanging.
I was trying to understand what everybody was saying. I asked so many questions that I drove everybody crazy. Mm. And, you know, I had to get used to, you know, I know Harvey and I know Jerry. But I had to ask stupid questions over and over to understand. I wanted to give them exactly what they wanted. I wanted them to be excited about the music and give them what they needed. I didn't want to be the one like, well, the story was really great, but, gave her a shot.
I try, you know, not to give her too much information. I give her the information when I absolutely need something. But what I learned early on was sometimes if I just set her up and then walk away, she comes up with
much
better
stuff. Well, she's an artist, and you have to let her work. That's
right. So we came to that History of Wrong Guys, Anna Lee.
Yes, I love that. That's my favorite song in the show.
Okay. But I've been here before. I called her up. I said, Christina, I said, we have a boy show. You know, we have all these boy voices.
I like that.
And I said, and we've got the girl. I said, I don't want one of those. I see you across the room and now I'm in love.
Yeah.
I mean, I cut out where Charlie's girlfriend was cheating on him. No, that doesn't happen in real life. I want this real life. And this girl's known him all her life. So she has to all of a sudden see him in a different light.
Right.
And I said, so write a song where she says, hey, you're not exactly who I thought you were.
Yeah.
You were not the I can't say that word on PBS.
You're not a putz.
You're not the putz. Yeah. I thought you were. And I left it at that, and I said, I don't know what I'm going to do. She goes, poor thing, she's going to be calling me in an hour. Well, she did. She called me in a couple of hours, and she had the most brilliant song, The History of Wrong Guys. It blew me away, and then we handed it to a great actress and a great actress, and she stops the show with that song.
Well, it's not as simple because
now
it wasn't
how it's
written
done,
as full. And I was looking myself, I was thinking, you know, first she was singing, I was like, I gave everybody a different style. I gave her, like, my Blue Angel. I was in a band called Blue Angel. Yeah. I gave her that style. Because I figured it's a definitive style.
It seemed very you, that character.
Well, maybe that was a mistake.
But no, I don't think so.
When she started to sing, She needed a definitive style, and it was handy. I could do
it's
that.
It's lovely, yeah.
Anyway, so she starts singing it. And I didn't understand her voice right away, so I had to listen. I watch. And then she started doing the accent in the play, like almost like Little Britain. And
what?
In the musical, I'm sorry. And then I started to realize, you know, she's really funny. And we got to finish this song. Because it wasn't finished. And then all of a sudden I said, it should be like this. The history of wrong guys. Chapter one, he's a bum. Two, you know, it goes into you. Three, he's a sleaze. Four, loves the girl next door. Five, loves the boy next door. Six, don't love you any no more. Loves his mother more. Is so insecure. Makes you insecure. Has a girlfriend named Nicola. You know.
Or.
Yeah. So, anyway. But part of that was her, too.
Yeah.
I'm a singer, so I let, and I know when you put on a song, it's like when you put on a dress, you can't just, it's not opera, all right? You don't stand there and sing note for note, because if you do, you never get the real thing from that person. You want to believe that all those words came out of that person's head. So you have to take all the mannerisms and everything and let them pour it in there. And what isn't right for them, you take that off, you pull it in here, and you let
her. Show me another composer that's going to do that.
She should be teaching the BMI workshop.
Thank you very much, Christina. Meanwhile,
look, the big stars of your show
are
the boots.
And guess what? I brought Michael's size.
No, no.
Yeah, I did. I bet you can get them on.
You're going to make me put these on?
I don't have a shoehorn.
That's all right.
Mom and Dad, look away. Look away.
Take off your shoes. I bet you they fit you.
Harvey, believe it or not, I've never had boots on like this
before. Oh, I believe you. I see your wardrobe.
Thank you very much.
And she sees your true colors, so watch out.
I have to zip these up like this?
Yeah.
Zip.
Oh. I know from zippers.
All right, you want to do it? Go ahead.
I know from men's
zippers. All right, I've never been in anything.
All right, come on.
That's not in the show.
Camera?
That was.
What camera?
Oh! How do my boots look? Where are we? Okay, there we are.
How horrible.
Well, come on, walk. Do
this
the walk.
This is going to turn every gay man straight.
As I can tell you, most transvestites are heterosexual.
Exactly.
90%, horrifying.
90% of heterosexual.
I must say,
how does it feel? It has a feeling of power, right?
Absolutely.
See, I told you what. See,
I'm so much
that's
power. I'm gonna kick my toes.
No, don't fake it. Actually, just let's walk. Let's just walk around the circle.
Right.
I just want you to see what it feels like.
Let's just
let it
feel like you're on top of the world.
Sashay a little bit.
And want to talk to me with them on in a couple of hours when you start talking.
Doesn't it make you feel different?
Well, as you know, I have. I'm very modest, and my ego is not so great, but this really gives me self-confidence.
It's the big one. It's the big one.
Michael, you look like Johnny Depp in Captains of the Caribbean.
Captains of the Caribbean.
Whatever that, Pirates
it's
of the Caribbean.
Pirates.
I'm playing golf this weekend.
This is what I tell people all the time. If you've never tried drag, you don't understand. There's a feeling of power in it. There's a feeling of. Well, you're going to think about it.
I know. I'm not taking
You're obviously not having a bad time.
All right. The show is called, if you haven't guessed, Kinky Boots.
And you know whose name we didn't even mention that we have to mention?
Who?
The fabulous, one and only, incredible Billy Porter.
Billy Porter, yeah. Right, who plays.
Talk about.
Can I tell you one thing, though?
You go ahead. They'll edit it into the Christmas show.
All right. Billy Porter is a force of nature. I have never seen a performer that puts that much in. It is, I mean, it must be totally exhausting, but then at the end, there he is. I don't know, I'd be flat on my back.
Well, you understand that my putting on these boots is an audition to replace Billy Porter when he leaves Kinky Boots.
Well,
she's gonna write a song especially for me.
Let him never leave Kinky Boots.
He's awesome.
All right, Billy Porter, never leave. And you know what? He only gets better and better and stronger in the role. It's amazing.
Awesome.
I love to watch him work.
All right, the show is.
I love you, Susan.
Do you ever get two words in edgewise?
Can you? But oh my God.
I can.
Well, why not, right?
Phil Donahue.
He doesn't have a job.
He doesn't. He's so nice.
And
do you think he put on these boots?
Yes.
Why not?
Yeah, and his old show.
I know his wife.
I think he actually would.
I think this is more Jerry Springer style than Phil Donahue.
Oh, I don't think Jerry
Michael
would
Michael
Wiener,
the opera.
That's right, exactly.
That's
a the show is called Kinky
what?
Boots.
Michael Wiener, right.
No, Michael Wiener.
No, no.
Oh.
Michael Wiener?
No.
That's somebody else.
That's somebody else.
That's right.
No, that's the guy running for mayor.
Goodbye. The show is called Kinky Boots at the Al Hirschfeld Theater. A wonderful script by Harvey Fierstein and a terrific score by a Broadway newcomer, Cyndi Lauper.
She's going to be on Broadway a long time.
I certainly hope so. Thanks, time. Thanks, you guys. And thanks for bringing the boots.
Thank you.
Right now. Good night.
Thanks, Susan. Everybody say yeah, yeah.
Thanks to the Friends of Theater Talk for their significant contribution to this production. Theater Talk is made possible in part by the Frederick Lowe Foundation, the Eleanor Naylor Dana Charitable Trust, the Corey and Bob Donnelly Charitable Fund, the Noel Coward Foundation, Carrie J. Fries, the Dorothy Strelson Foundation, the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, and the New York State Council on the Arts, a state agency.
We welcome your questions or comments for Theater Talk. Thank you and good night.